Hello, my broodlings. Welcome back to some more Mass Effect 3. We are going to look at a few clusters, systems. I did take a peek at the wiki for these systems. There's no items here. So, a spoiler-free peek. Hades Nexus. Hades Nexus, right. This is one of the new clusters recently unveiled. Pretty much right next door. Alright, Hecate. I remember that. Spelled a little differently than, I believe it's the Norse mythology. Would have a C, not a K. Wow, we got at least... Whoops!
I found something.
Fuel that we don't need. But at least we know the next one's gonna be on a planet. Alright, so we got Sheol, Pamyat, and Hoplos. So yeah, we're going to check out these systems for the next couple episodes before we go take part in the next mini-mission. And I believe we have just one small mission. Side quest, if you will. And then we're heading back to the Citadel, finally. So, the first planet, Asteria. A habitable planet known for its arid, sulfurous deserts, Asteria is colonized near the poles to avoid the uncomfortable temperatures that can reach 65 degrees Celsius in more southern latitudes. While the seas contain primitive animal life, little of it can live on land, leaving the soil to hardy plants that can survive in the extreme heat. Asteria is home to thriving human and Asari agrarian colonies, but little in the way of manufacturing or mining. Travel advisory. Carbon dioxide concentrations can reach 2,500 parts per million in Asteria's atmosphere. Citizens should carry supplemental oxygen for children and the elderly. Consult with local governments to discuss animal companion detection systems or other preparatory measures. Alliance Bulletin. Geth have been encountered in the Hecate system. All civilian traffic is prohibited. Colony founded in 2044 CE, population 188 million. The capital is Black Damp. It's an interesting name. Next, right here, Kerr. A dry, desolate planet, Kerr is temperate but supports little life above the microscopic level. Its Earth-like temperatures and gravity make it an appealing place to build habitation hideaways, attracting Batarian slavers and criminals who can't afford more luxurious safe houses on other planets. Its forgiving nitrogen-helium atmosphere makes EVAs possible with a minimal amount of equipment. A breathing mask and warm clothing is usually sufficient. Mining and other legitimate activities are few and far between on Kerr. The planet's crust is largely free of precious metals, instead producing kilometers upon kilometers of dolomitic limestone, calcite, and gypsum. Alliance Bulletin. Geth have been encountered in the Hecate system. All civilian traffic is prohibited. Blah blah. Ice Giant? Triodia? A modestly sized gas giant with an icy core. Triodia's hydrogen and methane atmosphere gives it a bluish color. It has 14 moons named after Asari virtues. Cool. I wish I could know the name of the moons. That'd be cool. But anyway, yeah, same notice. And finally, Bothros. A rock and ice planet, Bothros is home to a scientific curiosity. Evidence of a primate-like space-faring civilization was found frozen in its equatorial ice, ranging from melted fragments of metal to preserved remains of the creatures still wearing suits for extravehicular activity. Further exploration revealed that their habitation centers were vaporized by orbital bombardments from railgun-like weapons, hitting with a force of approximately 120 kilotons of TNT. Only those that fled or happened to be away from the habitats were preserved in the ice, where they died of asphyxiation.
Damn.
This unknown species did not come from Asteria, but scientific teams are looking for evidence that they visited there. It is difficult to believe they would colonize a frozen rock like Bothros and ignore a lush garden world. Their world of origin is also a mystery.
Same notice, and that's all the systems. So you think we could find the asset on Bothros on one of these other planets? They're coming. Yeah, I'm gonna leave. In a minute. Probe launched. Alliance Frigate Hong Kong. Cool. And updated for Alliance 5th Fleet. Can I head straight, like, I don't know, up? Yes.
Faster than light jump successful.
Pretty slow. Let's go to Hoplos. We'll swing our way back around. Interesting. Okay. Talaria. And I see that little thing right there. A rock with all traces of atmosphere burned away, Talaria orbits the star Hoplos at a blistering pace every 36 days. Though tidally locked, even its twilight belt and shaded side are too barren to support life. With so many resources on its sister planet Trident, Talaria has largely been ignored by the galactic surveying community. Tidally locked. Copus. Makara's largest moon, Copus, is a desolate place with an extremely thin atmosphere. Its crust is largely silica-based, and there are no signs of water. Like its parent planet, its high albedo keeps it from being a total inferno, and when occluded by Makara, its temperatures can be nearly tolerable. Its low gravity can easily be countered by a vehicular or personal mass effect field for comfortable exploration. Oh, how nice. And Makara. A small rock planet, Makara's thin atmosphere and high albedo keeps it from being much hotter than it is. The crust is high in sodium oxide, giving the planet a whitish tinge. Trident. A human-dominated world with over 95% of its surface covered by salt water, Trident is home to a dazzling array of life. The oceans are filled with creatures ranging from tiny bivalves to mammoth vertebrates, unequaled even by Earth's whales and ichthyosaurs. Small archipelagos create what little land there is, and its valuable real estate is fought over constantly. Underwater extraction operations have recovered a number of valuable minerals from the ocean floor, including iridium, uranium, and dust form element zero. A largely lawless world, Trident is home to a rogues gallery of unethical corporations exploiting the resources of the planet and actual rogues, criminals, slavers, and mercenaries working the shadows. Travel advisory. Due to extreme weather conditions, all traffic to the surface is grounded. Trident Spaceport Control predicts this condition will persist until the end of hurricane season. Colony founded in 2144 CE. Population 6.8 million. Capital is New Cousteau. Obviously named after Jacques Cousteau, the underwater explorer. Expeditionist, whatever you want to call him. Aegis. A hydrogen helium gas giant, Aegis was the site of an unparalleled cosmic event roughly 1.8 million years ago. An extrasolar body about 200 square kilometers in size was drawn into Aegis's gravity well and struck the Jovian planet, blasting enough dust and material into orbit to create a ring. An urban legend has grown over this event. The story goes that if the extrasolar body, usually called a comet, was unaffected by the gravity well of Aegis, it would have coincided with an orbit of Trident and created an extinction-level event on that planet. Prevailing scientific opinion holds that this is an exaggeration at best. Alright, making tracks with these systems here. Did we look at this one? Yeah. Alright, let's see if we find any fuel or anything. Whoops! I did not mean to leave the system. I do want to start at the top and work my way down. Whoa!
Signal confirmed.
Mm-hmm. 250 units. Full. Now, if I go here, we can hit all three of these. Hold up. So glad what we can... We have unlimited time to explore this. Probe away. We found the obelisk of Karza. It's one of the things we were supposed to find. Nice. 100% done.
Evasion successful.
2 for 2. Continuing to Pamyat. Units. Doesn't fill us up, but that's fine by me. Oh, we do have a Volkov or something? Volkov. A dwarf planet, Volkov has a thick atmosphere of nitrogen and krypton. Home to a thriving iridium mining community, Volkov's reputation is summed up as rich but dangerous. Pirates often lurk behind Volkov's two moonlets, Zeneviva and Alina, and cripple freighters leaving the atmosphere. To make matters worse, Volkov sits in the Chazov Belt, a field of asteroids and other small bodies, which leads to frequent meteor strikes on the planet. Meteor-related casualties remain rare, but on Volkov, the chances of such a death are high enough that they are factored into insurance premiums. Population is 3,800. See if there's any more. Because they are kind of hard to see in these belts. And again, we found half of our assets already. Okay. So the first planet in orbit around Pamyat is Komarov. Very Russian sounding. First charted by the Asari but colonized by humans, the Pamyat system is home to Komarov, an Earth-sized body near the star. It has little atmosphere to speak of, but this has not stopped exploration by robo-miners who have recovered iridium from the planet's crust. Dobrovolsky. Another near Earth-sized rock planet without much atmosphere to speak of, Dobrovolsky is home to Altai Mineral Works, a local extraction company noted for its success in Ezo refining. The planet itself provides aluminum for local fabricators, which are churning out habitats at an astonishing rate for a system that has no garden planets. With its ore supply coming all the way from the Sheol system, Dobrovolsky is held up as the proof of the miner's cliché, where there's Ezo, there's an economy.
And finally, Patsayev. A rock planet encased in frozen oceans, Patsayev was notable for the largest written message ever created by a human being. Andrei Kobzar, a disgruntled miner whose fortunes were spent prospecting for Ezo, used the mass accelerator cannon of a local mercenary group's A-61 Mantis gunship to carve a 208-kilometer-long message in the ice saying, "Zdes nichego net," Russian for "there's nothing here." Oh, largest as in big, not how many letters and such. The message used to be visible from low orbit. Ironically, the message itself appears to have been melted away by another determined individual with heavy equipment, and now, truly, there is nothing here. Alright, one of these systems. Oh my. We have quite a while. Unfortunately, they're coming from... Yeah, it's a long way to get out of here. Hopefully we will make it. Probe launched. The Alliance frigate Lipzig. Nice. We've got updated for Alliance First Fleet. Alright, let's try to get the hell out of here. Eek!
Reapers eluded.
Yay! 3 for 3. One more. Sheol. Oh really? Just one little planet? Gihanam. Right. We're supposed to come here for something, I think. A nearly atmosphere-less, tidally locked planet orbiting a red dwarf star, Gihanam was the first place human explorers discovered a dedicated Prothean burial ground. While a few sites were saved for posterity, Eldfell Ashland Mining successfully lobbied to scout the rest of the planet for Element Zero, and soon was embroiled in a scandal. Mining teams were looting grave sites, searching for Ezo and other treasures, and many got rich off the so-called cemetery business. While EAM, Eldfell Ashland, officially brought a stop to the looting, its mining teams remain on the planet, prospecting the unclaimed territory and taking the ore to the Pamyat system for refining. Travel advisory. Armed conflicts have broken out between miners and scientists staking claims to Prothean ruins. Visitors are advised to employ security while exploring unknown regions of the planet. Population is 11,503. Now let's see if I can find something else. Obviously there's going to be something on that planet. It might just be that planet. This is a really small system.
Signal confirmed.
And the thing's gonna come right from where I am, too. Hopefully one won't bring him here. Probe away. We got the Prothean Sphere. It was one of the things we were looking for. To bring back to the Citadel. Yeah, I don't want to leave from where the Reaper is. 100%. Done. Back to the mass relay. Oh, crap. That's right.
Faster than light, I'm successful.
My god. Let's fuel up at the Horsehead Nebula. Because I don't like going into a new system with low fuel. Or a new cluster, rather. Okay. Done with Hades Nexus. Awesome. Hades Nexus, not to be confused with Hades Gamma. Argos Row, we have not been to. And there's one or two others over there. Let's just check it out. How many systems? We got Hydra and Phoenix and Gorgon. It's a really big system. Oh.
I found something.
I'm just gonna check it out. 270 units of fuel. We could probably scan another two times. And the Reapers would approach on our third scan. Anyway, so, yeah, Hydra. Vormalis. Vormalis has a thick atmosphere of nitrogen and helium. Its surface is scorching hot and mainly composed of alumina with deposits of borax. The planet has an extensive network of subterranean caves formed over the millennia by volcanic processes. In these relatively cool areas, some primitive life has developed. Next is Metgos. Metgos is a large terrestrial planet with an atmosphere of carbon dioxide and nitrogen. Its hot surface is mainly composed of nickel with deposits of potassium and heavy metals. It is a mineralogical treasure trove, with concentrated heavy elements constantly being brought to the surface by volcanic activity. Metgos is inhospitable and dangerous, and expeditions must be well prepared to survive any length of time. With its high mass, heat-trapping clouds, and constant volcanic venting, Metgos seems well on its way to becoming a Venusian pressure cooker world. Thayar. Thayar is a large gas giant with traces of chlorine and sodium in its atmosphere. It also has a significant amount of water vapor in the clouds of its upper atmosphere. Thayar was struck by an asteroid at least 12 kilometers in diameter within the last 100 years. The superheating caused by the impactor's atmospheric passage created a large bank of vicious storms along the equatorial band. Okay, next is... this one. Fourth, Canrum. Canrum is a small rocky world with a trace atmosphere of methane and krypton. Its surface is mainly composed of magnesium and silicates with deposits of carbon. Canrum was the site of the warlord Shiagar's defeat by Turian peacekeeping forces during the Krogan rebellions. While this band was not especially powerful, Shiagar was a female warlord and one of the few remaining fertile females at that. She had, through viciousness and cunning, parlayed her unique value into a position of power. Krogan males competed for the right to join her band and lie with her. When Shiagar's death was announced, vengeful male Krogan admirers near and far swore blood oaths against the participating Turian crews. In the end, several thousand of the Turian participants were killed in open combat or through assassination. To this day, many Krogan proudly proclaim that they have the blood of Shiagar. And stuff. We got one more planet. I think it's down here, yeah. Ice Giant? Saiba? Saiba is a standard Neptune-type gas giant. The upper cloud decks of its hydrogen-helium atmosphere tinted a dramatic blue by traces of methane. Okay, so we're gonna have something on a planet. Crap, where is it?
Evasion successful.
We were doing so well, too. Be one of those two other... No, no! Wait! It stopped! Oh, I hit the controls with the mouse sometimes. Sometimes it just stops near the end, and then I die. Keep going.
Reapers eluded.
Thank you. Now if I come from this way, it's right there. Keep going.
Faster than light jump successful.
Hopefully I can get away. Probe launched. Haptic optics array. Cool. Now let's get the frag out of here. Oh wait, this button. Eek.
Evasion successful.
Cool. Let's go down to Gorgon. We're halfway done, which makes me think 2, 2, 2. Gorgon system. Planet Woe is a terrestrial planet only known from scan data picked up by unmanned probes. Though over 76 AU from the blue giant Gorgon, temperatures in Woe's orbit are still dangerously high. Only ships with a very powerful heat radiating systems can venture that deep into the system. Fortunately, Woe is not a terrible interesting world, except for its name. It has a thin atmosphere of nitrogen and methane, and the scorching surface is mainly composed of alumina with deposits of platinum. The world is tidally locked to Woe, leaving the The world is tidally locked to the star, I think they mean, leaving the sunward side scorched and an irradiated wasteland, and the dark side a frigid and icy... What? Leaving the sunward side scorched and irradiated wasteland, kind of makes sense, and the dark side a frigid and ice-crusted. This A should not be there. At the very least. And they mean tidally locked to Gorgon, not Woe, because it is Woe. Woe. Vectra. Vectra is a typical hydrogen-helium gas giant with traces of methane and sodium in its atmosphere. The heat of the star Gorgon is slowly blasting away the gas giant's massive atmosphere, which is visible as a long, dim trail that trails behind the planet. I want to see the tail. Show us the tail. All right. Third planet is Cameron. Cameron is a terrestrial world with a thin atmosphere of carbon dioxide and argon. The surface is scorching hot, primarily composed of iron with deposits of nickel. Like Woe, Cameron is tied locked to the blue giant, forever looking into the face of the Gorgon. Oh, very good. Charblu. I don't remember these planets from any other, previous games. A standard hydrogen-helium gas giant, the methane in Charblu's atmosphere gives it an azure hue. The Asari crew, who initially surveyed the system during Earth's 17th century, named Charblu after a then-popular soprano. The singer was renowned for her unusual skin tone, which was quite similar to that of the planet. And to me, it looks like a typical Asari skin tone. But I figure they know best. Where's this other planet? over here. Very interesting looking green one. Slekon. Orbiting at an unbelievable distance of 710 AU, over 66 billion kilometers from Gorgon, Slekon is a huge gas giant with an atmosphere tainted by methane and chlorine. Alright, so let's see if we can find something. Wow, really not finding anything here.
Signal confirmed.
Found this though. Probe launched. Advanced power relays. Oh, 100%. I wasted all that time. Oh well. Hopefully I remember to edit it out, guys. One planet, that's all we had. I'm not sure if I can make it there and back. We're here. That used about 200 in itself. Yeah, I gotta fuel up and go back. Oh crap. Are they all coming from that way? Then we're okay.
Reapers eluded.
Hello?
Faster than light jump successful.
And goodbye. Phoenix. So there's going to be a lot of stuff here, because we're only halfway done. So there's going to be three objects here. Let me guess, that's one of them. Alright, in the Phoenix Cluster. Let's check around the... What is it called? Patashi. Let's check around these... asteroid belts. It's not something, is it? No. There's another one here. Oops. So what is this? Oh, Pinnacle Station! Awesome! Can we land on Pinnacle Station? So yeah, there's definitely a throwback to the first Mass Effect. Pinnacle Station. It was a place you could go, and it was a DLC, with the place in it where you could train. And I'm really not up to training right now. Pretty much the most boring part of the entire series was Pinnacle Station. But I did it, just to, you know, complete everything, you know. Patashi. Patashi is a sun-blasted terrestrial world whose atmosphere was blasted away millennia ago by the star Phoenix. The surface is scorching hot and mainly composed of iron with deposits of tin. Due to its relatively low density, Patashi is tidally locked to Phoenix. Seas of molten light metals cover much of the sunward side. Okay, second is Silsalto. Silsalto is a standard hydrogen helium gas giant. It has no remarkable features. Short but sweet. Intai Sei. An atmosphere similar to Earth's made Intai Sei an early candidate for human colonization. However, prohibitively high temperatures and an arid climate have proven a hindrance to terraforming and agriculture. A few human cities were founded, but the majority of the human population on Intai Sei remains scattered across the vast deserts, operating wind farms and geological research stations. Colony founded in 2166, population is 150,000, and the capital is Thoreau Mesa. Next is Tuntau. I remember Tuntau. Tuntau is an enormous, low-density terrestrial planet with a thick atmosphere of methane and helium. Despite being nearly 20 AU from Phoenix, the star's great heat and the insulating thickness of the atmosphere makes the surface surprisingly temperate. Excuse me. I need a drink, hold on. Wow. Dry throat. The crust is mainly composed of sodium and silicon dioxide, with deposits of various light metals. While Tuntau is not habitable, the relative pleasantness of the surface conditions make it a popular location for small ships traveling through the Argos Row cluster to land for drive discharge. Oh, and the last one is... Alright, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points. Vebinok. Vebinok is a small terrestrial world with a thin atmosphere of krypton and xenon. Its frozen surface is mainly composed of carbonaceous material, water ice, and low-density silicates. Rare but concentrated loads of light metals have been deposited by asteroid impacts. One hemisphere of Vebinok is covered by surface deposits of oxidized copper. Approximately 270 years ago, a Turian bulk gas transport was attacked by pirates in the Phoenix system. Damaged, it made a rough landing on Vebinok. The heat of the landing melted significant quantities of surface ice, and ruptured shipping containers spilled lox across the surface. Ooh, bagels with cream cheese and lox? I love that. Before this evaporated and escaped Vebinok's weak gravity, it reacted to cause the widespread rust. And stuff. Pinnacle Station. The asteroid-based Pinnacle Station was originally constructed by the Turians to function as a concealed command center during the Krogan rebellions. It has been retrofitted as a military training facility for all high-level special operations teams employed by the Council. The station's combat simulator allows teams to train under a variety of hazardous conditions. Population 1,200. Radius is 340 meters. Alright, let's see if we can find any goodies. There's gonna be goodies. Let's hope we can find them all. Ooh!
I found something.
Cool, we found two somethings. units of fuel. There's something on this planet. Is there something to find at Pinnacle Station? I'm gonna check there next. Probe away. Oh, we found the fossilized cacliosaur. Awesome. Another thing we were supposed to find and bring back to the Citadel. Good. Our last thing. Where is it? Doesn't look like a station, does it? Turian Spec Ops Team. Sweet. Oh, it's an asteroid. Alright. Yep, see you later.
Evasion successful.
100% recovered. Yeah, I gotta get the frag out of here.
Reapers eluded.
Okay, so we have another system or two to explore, or cluster or two to explore, rather. And then we're heading on to that mini-mission. It is... N7 fuel reactors. Some of the stuff we just found. The obelisk of Karza we just found. The Cochleosaur fossil. I believe we found the... Yeah, the Prothean sphere. And one or two other things, and some more assets on top of that. So, thanks for watching. See you next time when we explore more clusters and head for the that N7 mission. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.